Elnora Evans Sampson-Brantley. The sad one was my father told us is when he was a boy. He was a motherless boy. He was born and his mother died at the age of, he was six. His father died earlier. So he had to live with an older sister that had a house full of children. And he was the baby of the family, so he stayed with the older sister. And they called him Babe. So Babe being little and spoiled, he wanted attention that he couldn't get from his sister that had a bunch of children. So he started going out in the woods and hiding from them because he did something wrong, which I'm sure he did. He got to go be spanked, he'd get up in the trees and hide in the moss until dark, and he'd come down and sneak in the house. When he got to be 10, 11, 12 years old, he started roaming around, visiting people around the country, finding little jobs when he got 12 or 13 years old. And he ran up on a white man that wanted him to ride, which is about 12 miles, to get a saddle for his horse. And they put little Al on this horse and sent him to this place to get it, and he lost his way. And he wandered around and he finally couldn't find it, and he wandered back to where he come from. And by being gone so long, these white people were not looking for him. And they found him way over in a pasture where there's a lot of cows, that's, we call them brumbles, that was very dangerous. They were very mean cows. And they took him off of the horse and put him on his foot and told him to find your way back through those vicious cows. And he said nothing but the Lord saved him. They didn't bother. And he finally made it to a wire fence where he came. Now that's the most sad story that we heard from him. Other than that, we'd have some funny stories. Now that wasn't funny about the wildcat. He loved to hunt. He was a good marksman. And this lake out that we lived close by had a, there was an island over there. He goes over the island to get him a early morning squirrel with his shotgun. And when he got over there, he heard something like a cat behind him. And he walked a little faster because he lived with no ordinary cat over that island. And wherever he went, he said he tracked, he was country born, so he knew how to track something. He did a lot of walking, and everywhere he had been, that cat was still hollering behind him. And he got a little faster, and the cat got a little closer. Then he realized what that cry was. It was a wild cat. So he knew the gun he had wouldn't kill this cat. So he hurried home and picked up his Winchester. But my mother wouldn't let him go back because she said, the cat is up in the trees and he might jump down off him. So he missed that cat. But I wish he had killed him so I'd had that story to tell how he went over there and killed that cat. Because he was very courageous during a big flood. We used to flood lots of Brazos River. House I was born in flooded and drifted down to a low part, and all that was left of it was a dead dog up in the tree and the iron stove that was full of mud, and, but all the other things was destroyed. And it was a white man that got stranded. That's when I said we didn't have any prejudice, as my father would have let him drown. Got stranded in that river and was up a tree. And somebody passed and saw him, this rushing water, and came to town where we were living and told him it was a man stranded in a tree calling for help. And my father got in his boat and went upstream in a boat. If anybody ever seen rushing water going one way and your boat going another, he had a fight. But he went with a rope. And when he got close to that tree, which had a current right around it, he hollered to the man, "When I throw this rope, you catch it." And he did. He threw it, I think, four or five times. Well, the man caught the rope and he said, "Tie it to that tree." And he said, "Every time I get up close to that tree, draw it a little tighter." And he got close enough for the man to jump in the boat. So he cut the rope loose and he safely carried that man And the cheers went up when he got back to where he was carrying him to. The whole town was on the banks of that river looking for this one black man coming down that swirling river with that one white man. So he looked for any pay for it, but that's the type of man I'm saying my father was. He never held a grudge against nobody. And I guess that's why he was prospered, because he taught us to be the same way. Treat people like you want to be treated.
Okay. Let's talk about...
What I would like to say about my mother, I've always talked about my father. And it's not very much I want to say. She's just very industrious. And he would follow through. But before they married, they were both poor. He was motherless, and she was out of family of 16 and oldest. And she asked her father, when she got engaged to marry, would he loan her a mule and a plow? And under the lake hill is where she tilled the soil herself. And he gave her some cotton seed. And she planted them and made one bale of cotton all by herself. She plowed it, she planted it, she chopped it, and she picked it. And he sold it for her. And that's how she bought her first stove. Her mother never owned a stove before then. She bought her a stove and her mother's stove. She bought her a lamp and her mother a lamp. And that's how, and I said that to let you know, she's very industrious, even though she didn't have nothing. They started from scratch. And they just kept building each year until they reached as far, I guess, as poor people could reach. I just had to put that little bit in about what she did as a child.
Were there problems with the law in your family?
Not with my father. After my brothers got grown, my oldest brother. Because we were taught not to work for white people. Mm-hmm. And that made it kind of tough. They didn't like it. And they tried to hire them, and they wouldn't do it. They tried to hire them to work for them, and they wouldn't. And my youngest brother left home because they was going to force him to work, and he didn't want to kill him. My oldest brother, we always worked for ourselves, so he would cut a wood, and what they call it, make a card of wood, because we all lived on a farm, and he didn't have to buy up a wood because it was on this, on my dad's property. And this man wanted to buy a card of wood from my oldest brother. And he carried it over to his house. And after he unloaded it, this guy told him it wasn't a whole car and he wasn't going to pay him. And my brother demanded pay. And he said he wasn't. So my brother loaded his wood back on his truck and carried it home. This black lady working for this people. And she heard the plot that night. That this upended nigger and what they was going to do to him because of that affair. And they got a posse together and was going over, they call it over the river on our farm. But the lady got word to my father what they was planning. And my father got word to my brother that lived about a mile from us and told him to get his gun and be prepared. He gave my mother a gun and he gave my next brother a gun and he took his pistol. And they stayed up all night. Each one of them, we had a huge house and they were facing the road waiting for those people to come back. They weren't going to wait for them to fire. They were going to fire the first one that came by. But then the next day, they didn't show up. The next day, till the lady got back word to my father that what happened. See, and they got back to the white folks' house, and they told them, I reckon the wives, and they discussed it together, why they turned around and went back. Because one of them said, we know somebody going to be left there. And who's going to be willing to do it? And that settled it. Nobody wanted to die, because if they had went, they was going to die, and they knew it. That Allen Evans didn't bother nobody, and nobody better not bother him. So that stopped that particular one. That's the biggest incident we ever had, a confrontation with the white people. Oh, there's a State Farm on the other side of it, but they always treated my father with respect, and they carried the convicts by the road and working them, cleaning the ditches. My mother was soft-hearted, and she would cry sometime and tell the man on the horse, "Don't hit him, please." But they would do it just to aggravate the black people, and get right by your house. They'd strike them with these whips or whatever it was. I was quite small, but I remember once passing and he hit a man because he wasn't going fast enough, and the man fell. And that's when my mother cried. He said, "Well, ma'am," now he was gracious enough, "Well, ma'am, he's lazy." I don't know what answer my mother gave him, but I know he didn't hit him. But so far as we haven't any problem, even though everybody was scared of they called them the convicts, because they would run off. They were so mean to them up there. And they would pass our place or go cross our property, and we know they crossed. But that wasn't our business, and sometimes we see them, but when they asked us about it, we didn't see them. And I've known the time my father would hang pants on the line. If they had run away and got his pants, he didn't say anything. But he could say, "I didn't give him any clothes." So if they went to ask him, "Where did he get these clothes from?" "Well, I didn't give them. I washed my clothes and hang them on the line. They took them out. It was none of my fault." So that never did happen, but I know he missed some clothes many times off that line in the back yard. No more trouble we really didn't have with them other than that. Now, they were nice. They would bring tobacco. See, they probably could get a lot of stuff. They would give my father tobacco. They would pick up our mail. The mailman was a trustee. And he'd stop and pick out our mail and take it to town, and he would bring our mail back. Or if we needed some from town, our dad could send by him. I mean, it was the guards and all, they were very good. And a lot of the convicts, they said the reason they didn't burglarize our house like that was the other little shanties. They was always breaking in. They was afraid. They didn't know who lived there. Because it wasn't a white person in that vicinity that had a house built on that's quality. So they didn't know was it white or what lived there. So we didn't have any problems.
Tell me about how your brother got killed.
My brother, no.
You want to talk about a difference in life now and then? Any difference that you see?
We've made a lot of progress between the races, if that's what you mean.
Yeah.
And even the job, because when I was coming up, if a woman worked at a place, she always had to go to the back door. I never did do domestic. I babysit. And I know it is a man delivering something there once, and he knocked on the back door. And when I discovered he was delivering something for one of the big stores there in town, I politely told him to go to the front door and told him, he was a young man, I told him, "Never, never go to no back door and you're delivering something to these white people, from these white people." I said, "They want your job, you let them have it." I said, "But don't stoop and come to the back door to bring something they don't know it." So I don't know if it helped him or not, but it just, I know I'd have had all kind of fits if I'd known my sons was working like that and had to go somebody's back door to carry him something. I don't think it ever happened.